I want to start out by talking today a little bit about what linguistics is. The word linguist, like most words, has different senses or different meanings in different contexts. In the military, for example, a linguist is someone whose job is to translate or interpret languages other than English. Correspondingly, for many people, a linguist is someone who knows lots of languages, or is a good learner or teacher of languages. On its webpage about what linguistics is, the Linguistic Society of America notes that linguists are not only polyglots and word lovers, but are dedicated to the systematic study of language and apply the scientific method by making observations, testing hypotheses, and developing theories in a quest to deepen our understanding of what language is and how it works as a cognitive capacity of human beings and a foundational tool for culture and society. The question is, what is it that's going on in our minds and in our interactions with each other such that we're able to understand each other when we talk? We know that there's some kind of highly structured conceptual and computational system at work in the production and comprehension of language, and we want to understand the details and intricacies of this system. Why do we want to understand this stuff? Obviously, we can't help but want to figure out how all aspects of the world work, just for the sake of knowing. But there are very practical reasons as well. For example, a solid understanding of how language works is important for people who want to perfect the art of learning and teaching languages. And it's also critical for advances in technology that can dramatically improve our lives. There are things that we can now do with computers and smartphones and Google Glass, for example, that weren't even dreamt about 20 years ago. And this is because of how good computational technology is getting with respect to language, in large measure because of contributions made by linguists. Even though we might be speaking in a random accent, and there's background noise and an iffy connection and all of that, our smartphones can now do a pretty good job of what we as human beings do all the time. They can pick up that we want to find the nearest Starbucks when we talk to them on a speakerphone in our cars, and then do way more than we can do, because they're able to search the internet and plot a route on a map for us in a matter of seconds. To illustrate further, consider these examples of conversations with Google.
Okay, Glass, record a video.
This is it. We're on in 2 minutes.
Okay, Glass, hang out with the flying club.
Google photos of tiger heads.
You ready? You ready?
Right there. Okay, Glass, take a picture.
Okay, Google. Compare olive oil and butter.
Here is a comparison of olive oil and butter.
Okay, Google. What is 5 tablespoons in ounces?
5 U.S. tablespoons is 2.5 U.S. fluid ounces.
Okay, Google. Remind me to buy olive oil on Sunday afternoon.
So Google can remind me to buy olive oil on Sunday afternoon. It's getting to be pretty good, right? But even though it can do some things way faster and more efficiently than human beings, it can't really use language in a way that human beings can. We can't just turn on Google Translate in a courtroom or a hospital and do away with interpreters. The technology just isn't good enough. Check out this example of Google Voice trying to transcribe a voicemail I got concerning a change of location for a tennis match.
Good morning, Patrick. It's 8:17 in the morning. I'm at the courts now. They're all reserved today for a boys' tournament, so we're considering a move to another court, the one down on south of here, just below. It's one of the parks south of Gibson. I forget what it's called now. Look for Clarence as you're driving up in the Kia. He's in the south park there of the courts, and I'm parked next to court number one. All right. Anyway, I'm waiting for our fourth player to show up right now. Talk to you later. Bye bye.
Yeah, it does a pretty good job, all things considered. And I can often get enough of the gist of my voicemail messages from the transcripts, such that I don't have to even listen to them. But a lot of times, it just comes up short on critical things, like names that go by quickly or get slurred, as was the case with the mention of Clarence in this message. Google just heard something that was close and figured would be likely to be used in what it took to be the context. It heard the word courts a couple of times, but didn't know that tennis was at stake. In a smart but wrong way, it substituted clients for Clarence. Although Google Translate can do a pretty good job with YouTube videos, if it's given a transcript of standard formal English, if we try to put any kind of colloquial language into the text box to translate, we typically get gibberish, as in this case. The question from the standpoint of linguistics is, what kind of script would you have to put into a computer to get it to truly understand and produce language like human beings do? Consider the case of Data from the TV series Star Trek. He's an android, which is to say, that he has the shape, appearance, and behavior of a human being, but is really a machine. His creator, or who he calls his father, Dr. Soong, programmed him to have superhuman computational capabilities. He can make numerical calculations of enormous complexity, more like the computer that he is than the human being that he tries to be. Although he can do most things that people can do in a fairly convincing manner, the story is that his father purposely failed to give him an emotion chip, and he therefore has a really hard time with humor, for example. However, he also can't do contractions.
Commander, I will have to confiscate your sidearm.
Of course. May I ask a personal favor?
Yes.
Will you take care of Spot for me?
Your animal.
I'm afraid if I have another waking dream, I might injure him.
Of course. Spot, come here.
Unlike a canine, Spot does not respond to verbal commands. Goodbye, Spot. He will need to be fed once a day. He prefers feline supplement number 25.
I understand.
And he will require water. And you must provide him with a sandbox. And you must talk to him. Tell him he is a pretty cat. And a good cat.
I will feed him.
Perhaps that will be enough.
So the question is, what would there have to be in the contraction chip? If there were one. That's what the job of the linguist is, to essentially write scripts like those that would be needed for forming contractions in routine spoken language. The rule is relatively simple, in some sense, so it's curious why the contraction chip was left out. Dr. Sung even had an emotion chip, which he put into Data's evil brother. Could he really not have come up with a contraction chip? In any case, linguists could have, as they are, above all, concerned with the conceptual and computational mechanisms that are employed in language production and comprehension. The script that makes language possible in a computer is something like what we call the grammar of a language. The set of implicit rules, if you will, that people follow in order to say things in a given language and to understand what other people are saying. So presumably the lack of contractions in his speech is one of the things that makes it possible for viewers to constantly remember that Data is really a machine. His failure to use contractions can't be blamed on Dr. Sung, really. It was a decision by the directors or writers to leave out a contraction chip. The failure to properly slur words together makes his speech seem contrived or mechanical, and that's what they wanted for an android. For human beings who are native speakers of English, he is, with two words and two syllables, becomes simply he's, with one word and one syllable. Similarly, I am becomes I'm, and does not becomes doesn't, and so forth. If we don't use contractions like these, our speech doesn't seem natural. So what is the rule system or the script that would need to be added to Data's programming in order to get him to use contractions appropriately? This is not something that we are ever actually taught when we learn the language as children. We simply figure it out from our experience with the language, and we employ the rule completely automatically without conscious awareness of it. The job of the linguist is to make this implicit knowledge explicit. What exactly are the possibilities for slurring words together, and what are the constraints that keep us from doing it in some places or in some ways? In fact, what's at issue is rules of pronunciation. And there are three possibilities in the case of he, followed by the verb is. One is he is, with two syllables and some stress on the word is. This can be indicated like this with the International Phonetic Alphabet, which is something that you will learn about quite a bit in this class. There can also be two syllables pronounced, but with no stress on the word is, which makes its vowel become very weak and reduced in duration. It's what we call a schwa sound, and the IPA representation is like this. This is what Data actually said in the first part of the clip. He is. The contracted pronunciation is really not very different, but it has only one syllable, he's, and is represented like this in the IPA. In essence, the vowel of the word is so reduced in duration as to be completely lost. The same thing happens in the case of tell him that there is a pretty cat. Ordinarily, the vowel sound of the word is goes unpronounced, and the final z sound gloms on to the preceding word. So the rule appears to be pretty simple. It can be formulated as a prose statement like this. However, it's not quite that simple. If it were, we would expect to be able to get three pronunciations of something like, tell him that the cat on Mars is a pretty cat. In addition to the way I just pronounced it, we should be able to reduce the vowel of is to get, tell him that the cat on Mars is a pretty cat. And in fact, we can do that. But what we can't do is reduce the vowel of is to nothing at all. At least in general American English, we can't say, tell him that the cat on Mars a pretty cat. Why not? Because the last sound of Mars and the last sound of is are the same. Z. And if we put them together, we wouldn't know that is there. So the rule has to be modified to include a constraining condition. I want you to notice here that the procedure for discovering the implicit rule is a scientific one. We ask ourselves the question of what the logical possibilities for this rule are and formulate an initial hypothesis. We then test that hypothesis by observing what happens in a range of contexts and then modify the hypothesis in such a way as to give a rule that will produce the correct behavior. We want a rule that can be encoded as a script in data that will get him to sound completely like other speakers of English who have the same accent that he is programmed for. And then we can go a bit farther to illustrate the actual complexity of our knowledge of the contraction phenomenon. We notice that there's a possibility for two contraction rules to interact with each other. There's a rule that reduces not to nt by taking its vowel away and glomming it onto the preceding word, as in, tell him that he isn't a pretty cat. But if we apply the not contraction rule, we don't lose the context in which the vowel of is can be deleted. But we cannot, in fact, contract is once unt has been added to it, as it's not okay to say, tell him that he isn't a pretty cat. So we have to refine our rule along the following lines in order to have it work correctly for data. I also want you to notice that the grammar of a language that the linguist is interested in is not a normative grammar. That is to say, it isn't the case that some people do actually say or write things like tell him that he isn't a pretty cat. And there's some style manual that says that they shouldn't, or it's not correct, or whatever. Linguists are concerned with discovering, describing, and explaining the implicit rules for producing language that people actually operate with. Whether or not English teachers or style manuals dictate that they should not. So linguists work on the grammars of languages and on general theories of grammar, but they're not grammar police.
We got a report of a teacher here using split infinitive.